everyone, it's Sam Johnson, a member of your youth preparedness team, here to provide you with a Pillowcase Project refresher video.
We love the Pillowcase Project!
First and foremost, we cannot thank you enough for all the time and effort and dedication you've put into this program since it first launched in 2013. From pilot to full implementation, this would be nothing without all of you.
Yay! We love the Pillowcase Project!
Our hope with this refresher tool is to create a quick training about the program and provide some of the why behind what we do what we do. We know you wear many hats as the volunteers who support this program, and as we are in our fifth year, details and some of the why behind the nuances get lost along the way. So, if you have any questions throughout this video, please don't hesitate to reach out and contact us at pillowcaseproject@redcross.org.
Send us an email.
So let's get started from the very beginning. The Pillowcase Project was created by the American Red Cross in Southeast Louisiana and implemented in New Orleans following Hurricane Katrina in 2005. Kay Wilkins, Southeast Louisiana regional executive at the time, had learned that Loyola University students carry their valuables in pillowcases when they are evacuated for Katrina. This inspired Wilkins and her team to work with an art therapist to create a program in which children living in makeshift communities across New Orleans decorated pillowcases as emergency supply kits. A Disney executive heard Wilkins speak about the program and was interested in supporting it. In 2013, a three-year pilot launched and the Pillowcase Project became a preparedness education program for elementary school students. In just a few years, it was adapted, expanded, and implemented by other Red Cross chapters with substantial success and became a standardized nationwide program in 2015 with program managers in every Red Cross region. Since 2013, the Pillowcase Project has reached more than 850,000 students.
Holy smokes!
850,000!
All of that is possible through the work that you do as program managers, presenter trainers, presenters, and assistants. We found that the majority of the questions over the years are about how to get involved as a presenter and a presenter assistant. So let's quickly review that. So how do you become a Pillowcase Project presenter? Well, there are four steps that you need to take to ensure you have the tools to be the best presenter that you can be. But before you do anything, it's helpful to watch the presentation demo YouTube video to help get you started. The link to this video is located in two places, one on the Pillowcase Project Toolkit Logistics page on the Exchange, and it can also be found on the Pillowcase Project Presenter Curriculum located on Edge. If you add the curriculum to your learning transcript, you'll see all the required training along with the recommended videos. So let's break it down. First, on Edge, Basic Instructor Fundamentals for Youth. It's a web-based class that will provide you with a basic foundation in presenting and teaching to students of different age ranges in a variety of spaces. You must receive 80% or higher on the final assessment that is included in the course. It'll take you from 60 to 90 minutes to complete. Second, on Edge, a Pillowcase Project Fundamentals Module 1. A careful review of the Pillowcase Project classroom presentation, including tools and resources used in the presentation and ideas for presenting to children. It'll take you from 60 to 90 minutes to complete. Third, in person, it's the Pillowcase Project Fundamentals Module 2. Here, you practice giving the presentation through a teach-back session to receive coaching and feedback from your instructor and peers. It'll take you about 3 to 4 hours to complete. And last but not least, your fourth step, which can be done on Edge or in person. It's the Pillowcase Project Fundamentals Module 3. It's an assessment of your knowledge of the program. You must receive 80% or higher on this. If done in person, a physical form can be collected, scored, and the score manually entered into the learner's Edge transcript. This can be done by any Edge administrator. The answer key is available to any program manager by emailing pillowcaseproject@redcross.org. If you take the assessment online, it'll automatically score and record for you. Something to also consider is that modules 1, 2, and 3 can be taught in an 8-hour in-person course. If a region would like to run an in-person course, the instructor and participant materials for module 1 and module 2 are available on the Pillowcase Project Toolkit Logistics page located on the Exchange. Prior to taking the training, though, you must complete the Basic Instructor Fundamentals for Youth course online. Here's some good news. Professional educators, which include those who teach in school systems or colleges, or have a current certification as a professional trainer, are exempt from the Basic Instructor Fundamentals for Youth course upon confirmation from the Red Cross. Red Cross training managers have the authority to determine if candidates meet the criteria of being a professional educator. If you believe you meet this requirement, please speak with your regional pillowcase program manager and email pillowcaseproject@redcross.org if you have any other questions. Now that we've talked about how you can become a pillowcase project presenter, let's talk about how you can become a presenter trainer. What does this mean? How is it different? Well, a presenter trainer is the person who can run the in-person Module 1 and Module 2 courses. Pillowcase Project Presenter Trainers must complete the exact same requirements as the Pillowcase Project Presenters, which includes the following. Basic Instructor Fundamentals for Youth, Pillowcase Project Presenter Fundamental Module 1, Pillowcase Project Presenter Fundamental Module 2, Pass the Online Assessment, which is Module 3 with a score of 80% or higher, and watch the Pillowcase Project Demonstration YouTube video. Presenter trainers will then review the Module 1 and Module 2 instructor manual and participant guides, and use those along with the training PowerPoint to deliver the in-person training that day. There are no additional required steps to be a presenter trainer. Preferably, anyone training others will have experience presenting in the classroom and will have practiced the full presentation several times and feel comfortable answering questions and training adults and children. We suggest having two people co-train if they haven't presented before, but this is not a requirement. We also just recently created a How to Run a Module 2 checklist for all of you presenter trainers out there. This checklist provides you with a list of all the materials and items you need to successfully run a Module 2 and all the topics you need to make sure you train upon. Here is a really fun side gig to consider. Maybe you know someone who wants to be involved, but doesn't know if being a presenter is for them, or they just want to see what the program is like before completing a full training. A great way to get them started is to join as a presenter assistant. This is a role where they assist the presenter by handing out and collecting materials, helping the presenter manage the classroom, grading quizzes, helping with reporting, and various other duties as assigned by the region. The only requirement to be a presenter assistant is completing the Pillowcase Project Presenter Fundamental Module 1. In addition to this, there are so many other ways for volunteers to get involved with this program. They can support as admin or logistics lead, help the region pull together materials, enter reporting, or conduct site outreach to schedule presentations. Please work with your region to meet the needs you have for the program and provide great opportunities to any volunteer interested in supporting the Youth Preparedness Programming Team. So now it's time to get out there and present. Yay! The essential documents you will use to deliver the presentation are the presenter's guide, which is your script, the hazard guide, which is a script for the hazard you are teaching, the hazard quiz, which matches the hazard you are teaching, and the three program posters. You will also bring along materials for the students, the pillowcases, the workbooks, the markers, and the quizzes. And if you are going to a school classroom, a teacher's packet for the teacher. Inside, it has a workbook for them, a set of posters, and three additional lesson plans. If you ever find yourself in doubt as you start presenting, just remember that Learn, Practice, Share is your lifeline. This will guide you through each section of the curriculum, and you can use the script in your presenter guide and hazard guide to get started. This is totally fine. We would much rather you present the material correctly with the help of the script than forget something along the way. Presenting should be fun, not stressful or scary at all. Here are some presentation tips to help make the experience less stressful. Read the lines ahead of saying them, then look up and deliver. Try not to speak into your paper. Make eye contact with the kids and smile. Go in teams. That way, you'll only cover one or two sections your first time and have your teammate go before and after you, following along so they can help you remember anything if you left it out. The more you present, the easier it becomes, and soon you won't need the script at all. For those who feel like you sometimes get off track, use a script in your next few presentations so you can be refreshed. When you're with a group of students, each presentation has to include the seven main sections. The seven standard sections include the introduction, the learn, practice, share, the local hazard of your region's choosing, which includes the practice activity and the sharing activity, the coping skill, which you can choose from breathing with color or symbol of strength, general preparedness, the pillowcase kit, the quiz, and number 8 is your extra bonus, which is the wrap-up. Remember, you have to teach a coping skill and students have to take the quiz. But why? It's such a pain and nobody likes it. Well, there's a reason for everything and I'll explain that next. So why are quizzes so important? well. Quizzes help us report to the donor and leadership how the program is doing, and they let us know if students are retaining the information, especially on home fire preparedness. This is how we collect data to get the gift to run the program each year. We need this information for future kids, so please do your best to collect data and enter it each month. We totally realize that some kids may not be super thrilled to take a quiz, so here are a few tips to help convince them that it's not a big deal and totally worth their time. Tip number one, tell them that this quiz is actually to test you, the presenter, so that we know how well you did teaching their class. Tip number two, don't give them pillowcases until after they've turned in the quiz. Use it as an incentive. And tip number three, you can tell them that it's anonymous, which means that they don't have to put their name on it, so we don't know their answers. Also remember, there's a separate quiz that goes along with each of the different hazards. Be sure you bring the right one along with you to the presentation. Check the sweet little icons at the bottom right corner hand if you aren't sure. Questions 1 and questions 2 are always about home fire safety. Questions 3 and 4 are on your local hazard. Question 5 is for the kids to tell you about their overall preparedness opinion. Note, it's totally cool if you want to do an entire presentation on home fire safety. There's a quiz for that too. Now we get to talk about the most exciting part of the program, which is supplies and inventory.
Let's talk about supplies.
And inventory.
How many dogs?
We have one dog.
All students who participate in the presentation get a pillowcase, a My Preparedness workbook, and the region has been sent enough resources that every kid should be able to have one marker. See your program admin for how you use your marker supply. You can also leave a few sets behind if students are absent, but these are not giveaways. We want a pillowcase and a workbook to go to each student who took the training. So if you can schedule a follow-up presentation, great. Unfortunately, if a teacher at your site point of contact asks if they can have a pillowcase as well, we do not have enough resources at this time to give them away. Our agreement with the donor is that the amount of materials we request each year is going towards training only students. Now for some fun general program management. Get excited!
Who is excited?
We are!
Reporting for the month is due online on the last day of the month. Help your program manager out and ask if they need any help getting all of the data entered. The link for the reporting form for the fiscal year is available on the Pillowcase Project Toolkit on the Exchange on the Logistics page. There are also tools on that page to help you and your teams, like a PDF and Word template that match up to the online reporting form. It's a great idea to print out a hard copy of one of these and provide it to the presenters along with their supplies before a presentation. That way, they can collect information from the presentation and turn in a hard copy back with any leftover materials. Many regions use hard copies to support their data entry and overall inventory maintenance. You are not required to use these, but they are a great recommendation and an overall best practice. You are, however, required to submit a report online for all presentations. It's how we keep track of total students reached and what inventory we believe each region has remaining. Everything that you could ever need for the program lives on the Pillowcase Project Toolkit on the Exchange. Can't find something that you might need? Email us at pillowcaseproject@redcross.org and we can help. Finally, we just wanted to let you know how truly grateful we are for each and every single one of you and your dedication to this program. You are the very heart and soul of this program, and we couldn't do it without you.
You guys rock!
And, as always, if you ever hear stories of the Pillowcase Project helping save a family's life, please let us know. We can help your region submit a live save verification kit and count those numbers towards the home fire campaign total. We also love hearing all of your stories. Seriously, they make our day. Like this one from Dan, who on a recent deployment to Texas, emailed Hillary and said, "Hillary, had to let you know, anecdotally, that kids were traveling with their Disney pillowcases as they were being evacuated from Beaumont. Pretty cool. Sorry no pictures. Just wanted to let you know." Or, like this one from Carolyn, a volunteer in the AOK region. She said, "I'm so proud. Our pillowcase project is working. Our team responded to a fire last Saturday. The people involved were a stepdad, a mom, and a 9-year-old boy. I asked the parents what school the boy went to, and she told me. I had just been there 2 weeks ago as a helper with the Pillowcase Project. The fire alarm went off and woke the 9-year-old boy. He went in and told his parents that the sound had scared him. They immediately got up and found a way to escape. When I asked the 9-year-old boy if he knew what the sound woke him up was, he said it was a smoke alarm. Whenever we do pillowcase, we always set off the smoke alarm so children will know what the sound sounds like. This boy knew enough that his family was in danger. A great testimony to the pillowcase. Dan, Carolyn, and all of you who have sent stories that brighten our day, thank you so much and keep sending them our way.
Thanks for watching!